Can you get both screens okay?
I have to switch from here to there.
Yeah, he's going to use both, right? So
yes.
Back and forth, I guess.
Right. Yeah. So it'll be a bit complicated, but I think I'll do it. And
force-free magnetic fields in plasma physics, I'll explain why, and they're called Beltrami fields in present to create the impression that Girl Eye feels stands at the center of a certain story. Almost 50 years ago, the Dutch astrophysicist Lodewijk Vulture introduced the following idea. He was actually looking to model the magnetic field of the craft, and the measuring devices at the time showed it to be stable over a certain period. So you figured it would sort of minimize energy or whatever else might have to be held constant. And if you let B be the magnetic field and A be the vector potential, he gave some arguments why you should believe that the integral A dot B would remain constant. And then he showed that if you try to minimize the magnetic field energy, the integral B dot B, while holding the integral A dot B constant, then the energy minimizing field, this is just optical calculus, there aren't multipliers, has to satisfy curl B is a constant multiple of B. Now the real truth is that even in closed systems on Earth, the integral A dot B doesn't really stay constant. But it actually decays at a much slower rate than the energy decays. So mathematically, you just make believe it's held constant and minimize the energy. And then you can match solutions you get against the pictures you measure, and it's quite a good energy. Is that reasonably visible to that? Okay, anyway, so this the equation curl of B equals lambda B is very believable for a stable system, because the curl of B is the current flow. And this would tell you that the current flow lines up with the magnetic field. That means that the Lorentz force, which is proportional to the cross product, is zero. So you could believe that the charged particles, which are causing the magnetic field, are not perturbed by the magnetic field that they cause. And to my mind, the significance of Vulture's idea is simply that it's a shortcut. It's a shortcut to let you calculate what you expect to be stable plasma field and then check them against the experiment without going through the entire magneto-hydrodynamic evolution, which is not so well understood anyway. Now, what Vulture didn't know at the time, but Keith Moffitt pointed out about a decade later, is that the real meaning of his invariant, which Moffitt called velicity, is that it is a measurement of how much the field lines wrap the coil around one another. And this velicity there is the formula for velocity. It's a little daunting the first time you see it, but what it means is the following. You just go to every pair of points in the domain. You have a vector, oh, excuse me for not mentioning, there's no need to take notes. I brought a copy of the transparency, and we'll simply make copies of it and make them available to you. So you can sit back and relax. So the way you should look at that formula if you see it for the first time is you go to every pair of points in the domain, and you see two vectors here. You have a vector field in the domain, you want to measure solicity. And you go to, and you look at the pair of points, and what you really want to compute, if you look at Vx cross V of y dot the displacement, forget the denominator x minus y cubed, that just makes it an inverse square law. What you're doing at the moment is just scoring how much you contribute to wrapping and coiling. If you get 1 point for this, you get no points for this, and you get minus 1 point for that. So that's the first, that's what the numerator does. The denominator says it's an inverse square law, so you get extra points for tight coiling. If you get 1 point for that and go half as much in, you get 4 points for that. If you get 1 point for this and go twice as far out, you get a quarter of a point for that. And then you add it up over all the pairs of points. So that's what velocity is. And it really is the first cousin of Gauss's formula for the linking number. So I have a wonderful half-page paper with no proofs in 1833. In the traditional language of the time. But it's the same formula, and it's almost the same formula as Calogariano's formula for Riding number. In fact, these two formulas differ only by erasing the prime here and letting both points, x is a point depending on a parameter s running along the first knot, y is a point depending on the parameter t running along the second knot, and you're counting the same kind of scoring again. And Calogariano dealt with the situation when both points run on the same knot, explained why the integral converges. It's a little frightening because the x minus y cube is the denominator, and that became the Riding number. Yeah, they didn't know what each change what? Oh, no, sorry. I just understood what you said. Yeah, no, that's what he did to work. It's three papers, 59. It would be a good accomplishment for him. Okay, so that's what helicity is. Now, why is helicity the same as vultures and varieties? So that's pretty easy to see. Just recollect the formula for computing a magnetic field. So suppose you have a current distribution B in a domain and you want to know the magnetic field. Then you go to... Yeah, you should be able to see perfectly just there. I won't say it anyway. You go to each point Y and ask, what's the magnetic field there? At each point X says, I will make a contribution. The contribution is measure the current flow there. And then take the cross product with the displacement vector from X to Y and divide out the negative inverse square law and add up over all the points X. And that's the magnetic field. And if you simply, that formula looks like a fraction of that formula. If you convert that double integral into an iterated integral, you quickly see that the helicity is simply the integral over the domain, so you convert a double integral into a single integral, of the magnetic field of the current flow B dotted with the current flow B integrated over the domain. And now, although in deriving that, B was thought of as a current, and Bs of B, the Bs of R, image of B as its magnetic field, you could just change your point of view and let B be the magnetic field. And if the magnetic field, of course, is divergence-free, if it's also tangent to the domain, then Bs of B is an inductive potential for it, so it plays the role of A. So you can see that this formula and this formula with that interpretation are the same formula, and that's why Keith Moffat saw that vultures invariant is just what we call the helicity and the measurement of this coiling and wrapping. Okay. So here's the way that we're comfortable looking at things. You have a compact domain in three space with a smooth boundary. That's omega. Let Vf of omega be the set of all smooth vector fields on that domain. And just look at the L2 inner product on that infinite dimensional vector space. So that's basically the average dot product of the vector field V with W. You just don't bother dividing out by the volume because that's just a distance vector. That's just basically the average dot product. Then, if you have a vector field defined on a domain and you make believe it's a current, and you compute its magnetic field, that magnetic field extends over all the space. Ignore it outside the domain. Just pay attention to it in the domain so that you can think of Vs as an operator for vector fields on the domain, vector fields on the domain. And then, from the formula down there for the helicity, you see that the helicity of a vector field is just the L2 inner product of the vector field with its image under this operator. Okay. Now we need to tamper with this operator for the following reason. What we want to really input for the vector field B is a divergence-free vector field tangent to the boundary. The output, of course, is divergence-free because it's a magnetic field, but it's rarely tangent to the boundary. So I just want to tinker a little on the next transparency. So let K of omega be the subspace of the vector field which is divergence free and tangent to the boundary. The letter K is just a reminder that we think of it as fluid knots, because when you cross this bridge back and forth between geometric knot theory and fluid dynamics, you simply take a knot, thicken it a little bit, imagine that it's an artery closed on itself, pump blood through it, divergence free and tangent to the boundary, and that's how you change knots into fluid flow. They'll always be divergence free and tangent to the boundary, so we just borrow that letter. And now compute, take such a vector field, divergence-free and tangent to the boundary, compute its magnetic field, restrict it to the domain. It is divergence-free, but you can't expect it to be tangent to the boundary. You can look at this little sketch. Here are the fluid knots, divergence-free. N is the unit out of 20 normals, so V dot N is 0 at every point, so that means tangent to the boundary. So here they are, divergence-free and tangent to the boundary. You input such a vector field. You compute its magnetic field and are disappointed to find that it's not tangent to the boundary. But by the Hodge decomposition theorem, the L to orthogonal complement of the fluid knots is the gradient fields. So you simply subtract off the gradient of an appropriate function, which will be harmonic because this is all divergence free. Subtract it off, and what you're left with is a sort of mathematician's tinkering of the V of R formula, modified V of R formula, which outputs a vector field is also divergent, different divergence free still, and also tangent to the boundary. And call that BS prime, indicate our metal. And then the helicity is still the L2-inner product of BS prime and B with B, because you subtracted a gradient field, which was orthogonal to B anyway, so it doesn't change the L2-inner product. Okay, so now we have that the helicity of B is an L2-inner product, this modified Diels-Alar operator. It's good to know what the image of that operator is. So, look at vector fields. AK of omega is the vector field which are divergent free and tangent to the boundary and have one other agreeable feature, namely, if you take a curve on the boundary and integrate the vector field along that, and if you're told that the curve bounds a surface in the exterior domain, you're required that that integral is zero. That's just a reflection of Ampere's law. Because after all, if you have a magnetic field and you integrate along it, that's the same as the flux of the current through there. Well, if it bounds the surface in the exterior domain and all the current is contained in the interior domain, there is no current in the exterior, so the flux has to be zero. And it's easy to check that that is precisely, so the name of Ampere, sort of these Amperian fluid knots, is precisely the image of this modified Diels-Alar. Then the point is simply the following. This modified Diels-Alar operator is bounded. It extends to a bounded operator on the L2 completion, and there is compact and self-adjoint, so you have the tools of spectrum. In that case, you get an orthonormal basis of eigenfields. And if you look at this ratio, Vs prime of V, in a L2-inner product of V, that's the helicity, over V dot V, that's the energy, then the eigenfields that correspond to the largest positive eigenvalue are just the vector fields with minimum energy for given positive velocity or maximum velocity for given energy. It doesn't make any difference which way you say it, because both velocity and energy are quadratic functions of D. Say it either way. Yeah.
I got a little over a moment with this. Can you just repeat what that operator is eating and doing?
This guy.
Yeah.
It takes a vector field, which is divergence free and tangent to the boundary.
Boundary of
The domain. So yeah. So you start with a domain omega, compact, smooth boundary. You input a vector field which is divergence free and tangent to the boundary. You compute its magnetic field. You subtract off the gradient of an appropriate harmonic function so that the result remains divergence free but is now tangent to the boundary, and that's your operator. And now the point is that if you go to the vector field which corresponds to the maximum positive eigenvalue, then you get the vector field either with max felicity for given energy or minimum energy for given felicity, however you like to say it. But minimum energy for given helicity will be the stable plasma state at helicity. And if you go to the minimum, negative one, you'll get the vector field with numerically the most negative helicity for given energy, or minimum energy for that given negative helicity. So the point is that the two extreme eigenfields are the stable plasma state. Now, all of this is good theory, but what does it do for you if you really want to compute? Okay. There seems to be lots of them here. Are we there? Okay, let's just try another one. Let's just see if this one's gonna work. Fix that projector, and I'll run the story right here. What do you suggest he does? Okay. So anyway, this was the last transparency. And now for computational purposes, this is pretty worthless. Even for numerical purposes, it's quite different. But what happens is, if you remember from physics, that if you have a vector field which is divergence-free and tangent to the boundary, and you take its curl, you get the vector field back again. That's sort of thought is immortalized in one of Maxwell's four equations. So that means, and furthermore, if you were to change this by a gradient field, it wouldn't change the truth of that statement. So that means if you take a vector field V, K of omega, compute its modified VSOR image, take the curl, you can write back where you started from. That means that VS prime from fluid knots to amperic knots is 1 to 1 and onto, and its inverse is curl. Okay, its inverse is curl. In which case, if you have found an eigenfield of the modified VSOR operator, VS prime and V is UV, then take the curl of both sides. The curl of the left-hand side is V, the curl of the right-hand side is mu times the curl of V. VS prime is 1 to 1 and onto, so mu is not 0. So divide it, and the curl of V is 1 over mu times V, call that lambda. So the curl of V is lambda V. What's the upshot? Is that eigenvalue problems for this modified VSOR operator simply convert to eigenvalue problems for curl on the appropriate space, AK of omega, and which means to a system of PDEs. So you can at least hope to solve them concretely. And furthermore, since the curl of a curl of a vector field is the gradient of its divergence minus the vector Laplacian, and since the vector fields are all divergence free, you don't get this first term. So if curl of V is lambda V, and curl of V is lambda squared of V, so the vector Laplacian of V is minus lambda squared of V, so V is an eigenfunction of the vector Laplacian, so by elliptic regularity is analytic in the interior domain, and as smooth at the boundary as the boundary is itself. So that gives you some sense of how nice the solution works. Now, so solving curl of V equals lambda V, looking for eigenfunctions of curl, is still solving a system of partial differential equations. In most cases of practical interest in plasma physics, the vector fields are rotationally symmetric about an axis. Almost all, but not all, plasma containment devices are rotationally symmetric. So let's focus on those. So now I'm looking for a vector field. I write it in cylindrical coordinates. U of r z times r hat plus v of r z times p hat plus w of r z times z hat. Curl of v is lambda v. And then the important component is the coefficient of v hat. And if you just insert and play, you quickly get an elliptic PDE, now a scalar PDE, for this function, little v of r z. And this is just a variant form of the grad shock equation. If you solve it for v, you quickly get u and w just by taking appropriate partial derivatives. So now the money is on solving a scalar partial differential equation for this function, little v of two variables r and z. And the condition on the vector field v, the capital V, that is in the image of the modified VSOR operator, translates to the scalar boundary condition that little v vanishes over W. That's understandable, because if little v were at zero on the boundary, you'd have a component in the v-direction, which is a rotational symmetric. Of course, integrating that way would give non-zero, but going that way bounds the surface in the x-degree domain. So v must be zero. So that means that you've got a Dirichlet problem for the grad shock equation. So now the money is on solving that. So just to take an overview of what I've said so far, this problem due to Bulger, from a mathematician's point of view, the motivation is to find stable plasma fields. From a mathematician's point of view, the problem is to minimize the energy among all divergence-free fields of given non-zero helicity, which are defined on a given domain and to its boundary. This is quantum view is finding the equilibrium state of a low beta plasma, so that's quantum which magnetic forces predominate over hydrodynamic forces. That's a reasonable assumption inside a plasma containment device, and typically an unreasonable assumption on the surface of the substrate. But anyway, so that's the Volta problem. That's the most primitive problem in plasma physics. If the chamber is not simply connected, there are other integral invariants, fluxes in the chamber, and you get the Kato problem, but I won't talk about that. So for the Volta problem, there are four basic issues as we see it. Find the explicit solutions if you can. That means rarely. If you can find it, that means practically always. Predict the qualitative behavior of the solution anyway. To what extent does it resemble the solution in the few domains where you can solve explicitly? The isoparametric problem is simply the following. Guess with the name. Take all the domains of the same volume. On each domain, you ask for the champion. You ask for the stable plasma state. You ask for the vector field which diverges free and tangents the boundary and has the least energy. In other words, you're asking for the principal eigenfield and eigenvalue curve. And now you run off a grand championship among all domains of the same volume and ask who wins the grand championship. That would be the solution for the isoparametric problem. And the problem of open domains, which I won't talk about today, but I'm happy to chat with you, is a problem that's of interest to solar physicists, because for solar physicists, the domain is non-compact. It's typically the complement of the sun and perhaps several other planets or stars. And the methods which are available in compact domains fail pretty badly in non-compact. Anyway, to focus in, I simply want to tell what we've been doing the last few weeks, and that's all on the isoparametric problem. So the rest of this talk is on that single. However, just, I lied slightly because I got this transparency. But here's slightly bigger pictures. There's the spheromat. That is the picture of the plasma field of minimum energy inside a spherical containment device. It's slightly misleading the way I draw it, because if the plasma were actually to touch the boundary of the containment device, it really has to be contained and compressed somewhat inward by magnetic field. If it touches the boundary, it loses all its heat to the boundary and even when you maintain it, it only lasts for fractions of a second. And here's one of many stable plasma fields inside a toroidal plasma containment device, the tokamak. And of course, you can see, the patterns are remarkably the same. And the basic pattern is there's a central orbit running down the middle. There are invariant tori which surround it. The vector fields on the invariant tori look like stripes on a barber pole. They look like constant slope flows on the torus. And the gain changed by 90 degrees as you go from the inner core out to the boundary. They turn by 90 degrees. Also, you can see that this picture and that picture are substantially the same as much as topology allows. If you were to kill the vertical orbit in the spheromat solution, and skim the orange, and here you skim this donut, the fields inside would be topologically equivalent. On the other hand, the geometry also constrains it. So for example, this is a rough picture of the tokamak called Dublin 3, owned by the General Atomic Corporation, to study plasma instabilities. And there, it turns out that some of the surfaces are no longer embedded, but become immersed, and instead of getting one central orbit, you've got an orbit here, there's actually another orbit here, and another orbit here. So there are certain, so you make compromises according to the geometry or the topology of the domain. That's the problem. Okay, so let me turn to the isoparametric problem. So now the game is to minimize energy among all divergence free vector fields of given non-zero velocity, define on a tangent to the boundary of all possible domains of one fixed volume. Equivalently, minimize the smallest eigenvalue of the curl operator over all domains of your volume. And what's interesting in this problem to us is that the spheromak field on the round ball is not the winner. And the main question is, why is it not the winner, and what is it? could imagine the following. Start with some domain, and on it, the winner for that domain, the principal eigenfield control operator. And now imagine deforming the domain in space, some way or other. Drag the vector field along, and let's watch how the ratio of velocity to energy changes. For example, if the ratio of energy to velocity goes down, then you're getting a vector field of smaller energy for the same velocity, and you're getting somebody who's better than this champion. So the principal eigenvalue for curl is the minimum value of the ratio energy to velocity of all vector field on the domain, which I've heard is free energy. So let's find out what happens to velocity, and let's find out what happens to energy as you deform the domain. Velocity doesn't budge. If you deform the domain by a volume-preserving deformation, you start with a vector field V on it, freeze the vector field in, like the printing on the surface of the balloon as you blow up the balloon. It just passively goes along with what you do. You know, the vector field passively goes along with the domain as you deform it. Then the velocity doesn't change. This is just a fluid dynamics generalization of the observation of Arnold that in a simply connected closed three manifold, the velocity wouldn't change if you simply subjected the entire field to a, by a volume preserving uniforms. Just the observation. And the same thing is true on a simply connected domain in free space, false in general, but true if you just don't take any old 50 applied observing at the moment, but a gradual isotopic applied. Then the velocity cannot change. So that means all the money is now on the question. Take a vector field in a domain, deform the domain by a volume preserving deformation, and ask how does the energy change? Everything is on. How did the energy do? So we need a first variation formula for energy. The setup is the same as before. Compact smoothly bound domain. And let me give a very general first variation formula for energy and then extract what I want from it. So for the moment, let's forget that the vector field should be divergent free, and let's forget that it should be tangent to the back. Let it be any old way. And have a volume preserving deformation of the domain, and let W be the instantaneous velocity field at time zero. The energy at time t is simply the integral of the domain at time t of dt dot dt, and we want its first derivative at time zero. That's its first variation. So first variation formulas are a dime a dozen. The question is to get one that works for you in this story. So here is one which at first glance, only a mother could love. It's too crowded. It's got four intervals, two of them over the domain, two of them over the boundary. But it's great for our purposes. Because, so this is just a very general formula, but for us, we only care about divergence free field, so that's zero. So you don't have to pay attention. And we only care about fields which are tangent to the boundary, and there's a term V dot N over here, and that's zero, so this is zero. So you don't have to pay attention to that. And when we start with somebody who's won the championship on his domain before we deform him, which means he's the principal eigenfield of the curl operator. So curl of V is lambda V, and V cross lambda V is zero, so we don't have. And now anybody can love this. This is all that's serious. So that tells you, if you start with a champion on a given domain field, which is the principal eigenfield of the curl operator, and deform the domain and drag the field along, here is the formula for first variation of energy, which says that all the money is on paying attention to the values of the field at the boundary. Pardon me? No, that's a derivative of energy. So the negative sign will mean the energy will go down if you do it wrong. Of course, if the vector field is, if the norm of the vector field is constant along the boundary, that's sure to be zero. You can't make it go down because W has to be the instantaneous velocity of a volume preserving deformation. So it is divergence free, so its flux to the boundary is zero. So the only thing that can stop you from making progress is if the vector field is constant in its length, constant in length, on the entire boundary of the domain. Sure. I'm just going to go here on the next time. The question is, somebody hands you a local champion. That means a given specific domain.
The W is the champion.
No, the champion. The champion is me. W is the velocity field for the proposed deformation. And you can change it. The sentence is that if V is constant in length, absolute value V is constant along the boundary, and then this integral has to be zero. We just take it out of the integral, you've got the flux of the divergent vector field to the boundary, which has to be zero. So you will get zero for first variation. Vice versa, if it's not constant, you can always fiddle with W so it stays divergent free, but gives you a non-zero integral, and so you can go the right direction to make it. So the money now is on the value of the length of the vector field V on the boundary of the domain. If you interpret that for the Grad-Chapranoff equation, then suppose you have a solution to the Grad-Chapranoff equation. We already said that little v equals zero, so remember that that's the v hat component of the vector field. I already said that if little v is zero, that reflects the fact that the vector field is divergence-free, tangent to the boundary, and satisfies the Amperian condition. That its integral along any curve on the boundary will be zero when that curve bounds the surface of the interior domain. Now the question is, what's the condition on little v, which reflects the fact that capital V should have constant length on the boundary? And the answer is that little v should have a gradient of constant length. So now, in order to get a domain which is a winner in the isotropic, at least a potential winner, you have got to have a solution of the Grad-Chapranoff equation with Dirichlet boundary condition, little v is zero on that, and with the extra conditions of the overdetermined problem, that the norm of the gradient v is constant along the boundary. I should mention that for the eigenvalue problem, the Laplace equation, this is the same, this is sort of the Pompeii problem, and the only solution is around. Okay, so let's see what that tells us here. Naturally, the vector field can't have constant length on the boundary. In fact, it's zero at the North Pole, it's zero at the South Pole, and it drips down the surface of the ball like rain falling from the North Pole to the South Pole. It's maximum at the equator. In fact, its length looks like sine of theta. Theta is zero. Theta is 90 degrees, maximum length. Theta is 180 degrees, back to zero again. So here's the first variation formula. A speedy descent is simply to choose the velocity of the deformation so that it's the norm of v squared minus its average value. Is this that? Now what does that mean? Well, if the vector field varies like sine of theta, then its square varies like sine squared. Sine squared has average value 1/2, it takes it 45 degrees. So if you look at, just forget the whole, just look at the boundary here. There's 45 degrees, there's 135, minus 45, minus 135. Over here in the equatorial regions, the vector field is bigger than average. So W.N will be positive. That's the instruction to bulge outwards. So this bulge is outwards. In the Arctic and Antarctic regions, B is a little bit less than average in length. So the instructions are W dot N should be negative. So that means depress. So in the first instance of speedy descent, this is what happens to the sphere. It gets flattened a bit from top to bottom, expands a bit. The question is, what happens then? So let me show another picture which also indicates the variance of B along the boundary. So it's just an alternative to what I said. So now the rest of the talk is computation based. We do not know analytically the answer, but we have an opinion computationally arrived at. Don't know that there is an answer. It's an absolute fair question. However, in our state of the search, we certainly won't stop to think about it. So here's a picture. So there is the solution. There are the level curves of the solution of the Grad-Chaffron equation on a half circle. That's just a cross section. You rotate a half circle around the z-axis, you get the ball. So there are the level curves, and the issue is, get up here is not too clear. I'll show a better picture. But anyway, if you were climbing this mountain, it's a little steeper to approach it here because the curves are tightest. Here the level curves are not quite so tight. It's a little better approach here. Easier and easier to climb the mountain from the top to the bottom than it is from the right-hand side. And actually, to help in seeing it, here is a picture of the norm of the gradient. We should have graphed the norm of the gradient. But anyway, same spirit. The point is that here at point A, here's point A. Here's point B where it's maximum. Here's point B. Here's point C where it's back again. Here's point C. And the instructions are when it's bigger than average, bulge out. When it's smaller than average, so there again is the same picture, slightly different view than the one I showed you. So you could imagine asking the question, what happens next? Time goes on. I flatten a little bit. I know what happens at the beginning. What happens as time goes on? Okay, let me table that question for just a moment, because you could do a different game, different evolution. Oh, sure. Oh, look, it's asymmetric. And of course, there's no reason to believe that the final winner, if there is a winner, is axisymmetric. It's just a question of making some progress. You could also start with a solid torus of revolution and ask, what will happen in the first instant as you deform it for speed and descent? So let me show another picture. So this is the tokamak solution. And the torus of revolution is obtained by taking that green disk and rotating it around the z-axis. And here again are the level curves of the principal eigenfunction for the Grad-Chaffron equation. And again, if you stare, and I think of this as the contour map of a mountain, it's easiest to climb the mountain from here. It's medium difficulty to climb up here. It's toughest to climb the mountain there. And again, you can label it. It's toughest at A, easiest at B, and here you're back to A again. So that means that where it's toughest to climb the mountain, the gradient is bigger than average, and the deformation field points outwards. Where it's easiest to climb the mountain, norm of B squared is less than average, and the deformation field points inwards. So that's clear enough. This torus is beginning to try to hug the z-axis. That's not surprising, because if you're trying to minimize energy for fixed velocity, that's like maximizing velocity for fixed energy. And just think of a toroidal school of again, the question is, fine, but what happens then? You have to be liberal as you listen. So here, in this case, you can do two things. You can squeeze it naturally as it gets closer into the z-axis. You better make the cross-section bigger if you want the line to be the same. Or you just don't care about it. You just correct the eigenvalue and change your mind. Makes a difference. Now, in your mind, you want the line to stay the same. You can either run the computational run so that the volumes really do stay the same, or you run it so you don't care, and at each stage, correct the eigenvalue. You know how the eigenvalue depends inversely on this game. Okay. Now what? The question is what happens eventually. So we run this. In fact, we are running it now. So our proposed answer is that do it from the torus's point of view, and it comes, compresses in, and it hugs the z-axis. It kisses it at the origin, and then it begins to eat it up. It swallows it, and doesn't quite grow to be a ball. It doesn't quite grow to be a round ball. It stops a little bit short of that. And it stops, now let's see. Why do you see that it stops? This mountain is equally easy to climb with any of these approaches. And here is a graph of the norm of the gradient of the solution of the Grad-Chapranoff equation along the bottom. That's what we think numerically, anyway, is the limiting position of this computational run. That's the one that you stop. The question is maybe which circle is it? And incidentally, in this game of hugging the z-axis, it starts as a torus of revolution with a circular cross section. It loses circularity as soon as it moves, but it regains it. Which circle?
Do you think?
That's correct. It's got two. I'll show you an actual Friedman. The limiting guy. When you rotate this around the z-axis, you've got two conical-like singularities. Is that what you're asking me at the pole? Yeah. Poles and the vector field there, and I'll show you the vector field also. Well, Reese asked me if I was going to mention the word calibration in all this talk, and I really didn't intend to, but of course. after all, calibrated geometry is after you get above the lowest dimension. Typical volume minimizing cycles have beautiful singularities, so why is it hard to imagine that a winner here should get some singularity? And when the domain gets, well, I'll show you the vector field, when the domain gets a singularity, the vector field feels relieved from obeying the usual roles of the social behavior, and it also has a certain singularity, which is interesting. Which circle do we get? Three decimal places, I mean, it would be a miracle if this really is two-thirds, but the computational run, three decimal points of accuracy is 0.667. That's what we seem to get. When we asked ourselves, is it really circular? We started with the domain, took the circular best fit, red and superimposed the two. The little jiggy jags here, we think, are computational discrepancies near the axis. No. Here's another picture of the level contours of this solution of Grad-Chapranoff. It's more colorful, it has fewer contour curves, and it's easier to see with the naked eye. That you could believe that the norm of the gradient is constant along the curvy part of the mountain. It's also interesting to see some of the higher eigenfunctions. It would seem not at all pertinent to the story. Let me show the picture. So there's the first eigenfunction eigenfunctions functions of grad shots are not the same with your psychometry. Here are the first six eigenfunctions. We happen to be talking at lunch quite a time about sophomore calculus. So in a sophomore calculus mode, you could just imagine that this color sort of leaks out and fills the whole square. And you could almost imagine you are finding the eigenfunctions of a Laplace equation on a square. Just imagine that, just to get to the right movement. Then the name of the one in the upper left-hand corner is sine x times sine y, if you're doing sophomore calculus and it fills the square. Then the name of this one is sine x times sine 2y, if you're doing sophomore calculus. This is sine 2x times sine y. Sine x times sine 3y, this is sine 2x times sine 2y, this is sine 3x times sine y. If those were filling up the square, and you may believe these are the solutions of the Einstein problem. I may come back to that transparency at the very end. We print it out at first because we just like the pictures. Then there's an interesting use for it. What's the field? That's easy enough to translate back to the three-dimensional picture. Here's what we think the actual field looks like. Very much like the Sphermat field, except that instead of being a round ball, it's sort of depressed a bit at the North Pole and inserted a bit at the South Pole. It's sort of like an apple. It's got a conical singularity at those two points. And the vector field itself is multivariate. Very good eye. The principal eigenvalue of the curl operator on a ball of unit volume is about 7.25. And the principal eigenvalue of this is about 7.0 something. So it's off by 1/4 out of 7, so it's off by 1 out of 28, so it's off by about 4%. Yeah. So the principal eigenvalue of the curl operator, this domain, is 4% less. Of course, this is just the computational evidence that we have. Not much more. So naturally, you don't even know if this is stable. So you want to test, is it stable?
Well, your computation shows you can do it.
Do you mean? Oh, yeah. Well, of course, yeah. We did very well. Absolutely. Is it stable? I'm perturbed. Does it have a smallest eigenvalue in a bigger family of solutions, not just the ones we gave rise to? So here is the, so we ran a run on that. So we took a two-parameter family of domains. In one direction, they are circular domains coming as this. And in the other direction, you press down this way and expand out that way to make the cross-section, make the whole domain more loose. And in that case, we run a two-parameter family. And our domain comes out at the center. So in other words, it is the winner in that two parameter. Now, what's to be done? Pretty obvious. Computationally, what we're actually running it right now is most of the computation in the last few weeks we're done with the PD toolbox on math. Much more sophisticated than next week's tools. So we're rerunning the evolution at this moment to try to achieve eliminating domain again, both from the point of view of the torus hugging the z-axis and swallowing it. Likewise, which we have not done before, from the point of view of the sphere jumping in and swallowing it. Naturally, you want to improve the evidence for stability. However, all of that's computational, and analytically, it's pretty clear. We love to find the limiting domain exactly. These are really a circle, or it's just a circle of three decimal points. And prove its stability. It wasn't done by diffeomorphism. In other words, I started by diffeomorphisms, and then I just ran and let it plug the change of topology. For example, if you do it this way, as soon as it kisses the z-axis, it changes the topology.
that's what I'll just keep going. That's right. No, that's right. But what we're doing here is just letting the domain change and solve it. Any chunk into the domain, solve the grad chunk. So it's a domain change and a topology change. Want to kiss the z-axis? Topology change. The domain change the z. The domain change and it just touched the z-axis. You let it. There's also the question, of course, of analytically solving the eigenfunctions. So it started off being by volume reserving the diffeomorphisms. Then we just liberalized it. All these questions are obvious. Is it the winner among rotations of metric domains? Is it the overall winner? I'll come back to this picture for one moment. The question is, how can you actually solve the grad chunk equation in closed form on this domain? So here's the use of these eigenfunctions. Popular solutions are by separation of variables. How do you solve a single PDE? Either by separation of variables, or there are various modifications of this, which you pull out a certain kernel function and solve by separation of variables. And you'd like to be able to check, will anything like that work? Or are you at the mercy of some other method that you don't know? So here's a trick for finding out. You take, let's think of separation of variables. So you have, all functions of x and a whole bunch of functions of x is f1, f2, f3, whole bunch of functions of y, fg1, g2, g3, and you begin to assemble solutions f1 of x times g1 of y, like sine x, sine y, sine x, sine 2, sine 2x, assemble them. Now, so start dividing one by the other. Well, at some point, you probably had a sine x times sine y, and a little later maybe a sine x times sine 2y, and when you divided one by the other, you get just a function of y. And therefore, if you plot its level curves, you will see the y-coordinate curves. So what we did is we took the first 16 eigenfunctions for the grad Schottenkamp equation, computationally indeed, of which these are the first six, and divided one by another, getting 256 quotients, and plotted their level curves. If you can solve it by separating the variables or any of the popular variations of this, there should be repeated appearances of the appropriate coordinate curves that work with separating the variables. And the best will be examined by our eye, they do not. So we think that the various popular techniques, which are sort of modifications of separating the variables, do not work with the grad Schottenkamp equation in this theory. And finally, what's the connection of all of this with physics? And in our minds, there are really two connections. So for 50 years, one reports that inside spherical plasma containment device, you can measure the magnetic field. You have many, many little loops and chain, and then you can measure the magnetic field using those powerful loops that you have yourself.
there's a natural generalization of this equation into a non-abelian dimension. So from U1 to other groups.
Say this again?
So you were studying a U1 gauge there. So you have a vector with a connection and then U1 bundle. So you can take that and generalize it to higher rank bundles. Where the angle of eta and b is turned time and action.
Right, I know.
So these might also end up being interesting for physics, for example, there are quantum hall effects which suggest it might be related to these non-abelian potential. Has there been any study of the situation where you fix the Church-Simon action and vary the energy and see if it's
possible? It may indeed be, but I don't know.